I'd like to thank you all for attending what I think will be an inspirational speech by Pam. Pam Boyce, who's sat down like a night of the way, who's the founder of Incredible Edible. I first met Pam about a couple of years ago, came to a cabinet meeting with myself and Peter. Susan Lowden was back to her, and I thought, who's this passionate, zany, mad, crazy woman? And that's Pam. She's very zany, but very knowledgeable. I think in life we all come across people who are talkers, and Pam is definitely a doer. I think that's been listed. I had a look on Wikipedia today, some of the stuff that Pam's done, and actually she used to be a council leader, she chaired the Forestry Commission, and she was awarded the OBE in 2005. And if you look under, there's many more attributes to Pam. But what did make me laugh, or smile, should I say, when I was at work today, I did all that and looked at all this stuff, and there was a big list of it. And at the end, it says, Warhurst, not Pam, Warhurst, I still lives in Tottenham. That was the bottom line. Well, it was like a prison in this one. Pam came to a community meeting last week and spoke to lots of people we know, community groups, about the Edible Project. And I think it was one of the things that stuck in my mind was the barriers, and not barriers, but opportunities, and we need to get around those barriers to actually create something. When I listened to Pam, the impact she had was unbelievable, really. And what I thought about was, what impact could she have on elected members? That was about community groups. And what stuff could we take away from what Pam does? But one of the things was, and we all have problems with it in our wards, is small pockets of disused land, which we can't get council to clean up, we can't get private people to clean up. And actually, because of the constraints we've got at the council, and they're full of litter, full of bottles, in some instances full of needles, and we've all gone through that. And what Pam said at the meeting was, we could change them pieces of land into patches where you can grow stuff, and what you have, herbs, vegetables, whatever you want to grow. And I always think to myself, and I said it at the meeting, cabbages must be safer than needles, and bottles and tins and cans and everything like that. So Pam's going to tell us a bit about what she's done in the past, what she wants to do at Wigan, with our support. And what I'd like is if we can take questions at the end, so Pam can give you a full group of it. So really, what I'd like to do now, I'll do finish my bit, and I'll come in at the end, look at if we need to do. I'd just like to give Pam a warm welcome for Pam coming to Wigan tonight. So thank you, Pam.
Thank you very much. But I have kind of been living the past 30 years over in Yorkshire. But we have a lot in common, so I hope you don't mind me telling you the story about the things we've been doing in Yorkshire. And I hope that you can see there's a lot of resonance about what's happening already over here. And I just want to tell you a story, but maybe I can give a little bit of background to why I'm here telling you this story. For two reasons. First of all, the thing that I am more than anything is a mum. And the thing that occupies my mind more than anything is what sort of world will pass it over to people like my daughter. She's 30 odd, but she's still my daughter, and it seems to me that there's a whole host of challenges that we're all trying in our own individual ways to do something about. But each and every one of us has the capacity to do something really positive to create a kind of world if we can all work collaboratively together to find what is that language. And what is that story that we can share that makes every one of us, whatever our age, our income, whatever our culture, our ability, to say, I can do that, and start to do something that starts to not only change the place around us, but change our own perception of ourselves. Because all the stuff I have done, and I have done all that other stuff at a local, regional, national, international level, whatever, of all the things I've done, the one common thread through it all is if people have the will to change, they can change. And if people can help to create kind of frameworks within which people can change, we can make that happen even faster. So 8 years ago, I've been doing this for 8 years, I've never done anything in my whole life more important than this, and I'm probably going to do it to the day I drop off my perch. 8 years ago, I just took a view that, you know, I couldn't wait for the world's leaders to start to do something about the big changes that are happening. The climate, finances, health, whatever. I couldn't wait for all that, because I've lived through the Rio Summit, for those of us that are old enough to remember that, and Kyoto, and Copenhagen, and heaven knows what, when we were promised a lot of stuff that never, ever happened. Well, let's not be negative about it. They tried, I'm quite sure they had a bash, but it just didn't quite come off. So I thought 8 years ago, why not do something myself and not expect other people to do it, but just tell a story? Why don't I start to think about living my life differently in some way that's not worthy and, you know, sort of hand to the brow or wherever, but it's full of fun and joy and positivity. Why don't I try and do that? Why don't I see if I can find some experiment that we could all have a crack at by sharing some common facts between us? So this is a thought that happened in a conference in the middle of London. And I got on a train, it was a Virgin train, and 2.5 hours later, I invented a model. And it was a small model, and a very simple model, because I'd only got a Virgin Serviette to draw it on. And the simple model was, if we use food as the driving force for change, local food at the heart of the place that we call home, don't matter where it is, Lee, Tilsley, Tobbedon, Bristol, Duckhead. What if we did that to see if we could actually change the world around us and our own relationship? All a bit crazy. What if we could imagine the way that we live our lives is three different plates full of food? One is community, which is food everywhere in the landscape of our lives, on our high streets, our doctors, our railway stations. What if our children walked through food all the time? Would that change their relationship to how they saw their place, how they thought of where their food came from, whatever? I don't know, it was an experiment 8 years ago. And what if on the learning front, I don't get wound up about what's in the curriculum or not in the curriculum, but actually we ourselves start to share the gifts we've all got. Many of the older community who are often, you know, have issues around loneliness, know a heck of a lot. They know how to pickle them, bottle them, preserve them, do all manner of things, but nobody ever can people ask them whether they can do it. And they become victims, and they're not victims. They're people to be respected in a community that's often forgotten. And then what if we remember we get the economy we spend our money on? So if we start to spend the pound in our pocket on more local produce in support of our local market, instead of without thinking, because we're in a rush, I get that, zap into the supermarket and getting something in a plastic bag from anywhere on the planet, what if we stop doing that a little bit, if we could, and started to buy more local stuff and support more local traders? Right, what if we did all those things together just as a way of living, not a project, not waiting for a check, not with a sign of something that says you have permission, but just what if we did that? Might it just change the way that we think about things? Well, 8 years on, I've got lots of photographs, which I didn't have 8 years ago, so I'm going to show you loads and loads of photographs and zap through it all, because I've got to say it's had the most amazing effect wherever it's touched base. And no, it's not the universal panacea for world peace. And no, there's still a heck of a lot of other people. Actually, there's thousands and thousands of people now who know they have the capacity to do something that's of real value. They are not the people who are part of the problem. They are the people that's part of the solution. So here's the pictures. Right, now I know Wigan's not on this yet, but just hold that thought. So here's the incredible story. It's about what can we do all over the country, but in particular, I'm interested in what we can do in the north of England, that so-called Northern Powerhouse territory. What if we started to think about what we could do collectively across the northeast and Humber and the northwest? What if we made connections? I'll come to that at the end. Could we not start to challenge a system that's not quite working for everybody that it should be working for? Okay, this is Tottenham, this is where I come from. So it's great, it's 14,000 people. It's got, you know, lots of winds and sheep falling over and the land's marginal. And it's not the place that you'd imagine a food revolution. It's got the usual issues around failing schools, it's got the usual issues about unemployment, it's got the usual issues about health and well-being and all the other stuff, but it's my home. So it's where I'm gonna start. And that's what it looked like, and on some days it still does a bit, but it's looking more like this as well. Not instant sunshine, but what it's got is food all over the middle of the place where people walk. This is along the canal bank. We've got it outside of doctor's surgery. We've got it at the police station. We've got it at the railway station. There's no point in offering these sorts of what we call propaganda gardens of food to share at the bottom of a street that nobody passes. What we've created all over the middle of Topperton is lots and lots of edible spots with signs in them that say this is food to share. And what that does is not feed 14,000 people, because we're not banking money. What that does is stop people in the tracks and say, oh, that's interesting, what's that? And then, over time, over years, well, what do I do with that? Oh, don't you remember your grandma used to? And it starts a conversation between complete strangers, because that's what food does. And people can share it, and they can pick it. But, you know, often they don't know what it is or what to do with it, so you've got to use your nose. So we make little kind of like notice boards that say, you know, when it's red, it's not ready, when it's amber, it's getting there, when it's green, you can help us out. We've got sign makers now that come along to our propaganda gardens and offer to make us signs. Because people want to be part of something that's really positive and wonderful. So we've got these propaganda gardens all over the middle of town. And that is one of the hallmarks of Incredible Edible. Here's the model. Community meets learning, meets business. This is not a cabbage growing initiative. There is nothing wrong with growing cabbages. But what we're growing is people who know they can do stuff that before we started, they didn't know we could do. So let's imagine that's one of the planes that fits together in the framework of our lives. Community, let's get propaganda gardens all over the place. I'll show you some examples. Learning, let's share the skills that we've all got. Let's try and work around what the good stuff that's happening in schools is, but help the families of those people in the schools also do that when those kids leave the schoolyard. So they don't eat well in the school and hot noodles outside the school. Oh, they don't eat well during term time and rubbish during holidays. This is not rocket science, we all know, but we've just got to go up our sleeves and do something about it. So what if we did on that learning? And then the business, I've already said. You do get the economy. I'm an economist, I'm not an environment. You get the economy, you spend your money on. It's not as simple as that, I know. But we've got a market that was failing and now it's better. I'll show you some pictures. You've got a market that could do with a bit of a help. I've just been around there today and it's starting to get better and better. If we can help in some small ways, nothing rocket science about anything I'm saying, but if we can help by saying to people, you can make a difference, look at what we've had in the backyard. We didn't get it all right, we got some of it right. Can we share some ideas with you? Okay, let's look at some edible landscapes. So this is the first one that we actually did. This is a grass verge which technically, or actually, not technically, actually, belongs to the council because it's public realm, except it's got public in front of it, which means to say it's people's realm. And it was a verge, and it was a dog toilet, and nobody liked it. And the council hadn't got any money to mow it. So people kind of like ignored it and then threw cans down and all the stuff that you were talking about before. And it was pretty naff. It's on the main road towards Burnley. So we didn't ask the council permission to do anything about that, because why would we ask anybody's permission to clean up a dog toilet? So we went out there with our own resources and our own plastic gloves and whatever else it was, and we cleared it up and we planted food. Very simple. We planted, you can see some things there, we just planted herbs, some fruit bushes, whatever we got in our back garden or that we got in our bottom drawers that we bought on the seedlings, whatever it was, and we created that herb garden. And it looks lovely, when before it didn't. And it didn't cost anybody hardly anything at all. And the wonderful thing about it, and I adore councils, and I'm not being patronising, my staff are, oh, my offices are going to bits, but these offices were even better because what they did is they started mowing the grass and we never asked them. And they put a bench in there so people could sit and enjoy it and we never asked them. They've got a bench in the shed, now it's out of the shed. And everybody feels better and everybody can do it. And sometimes you need it more formal. This happens to be in Bristol because this is happening all over the place where, you know, they're really posh in Bristol, I don't know, whatever, but they got some wood. The point is they got some wood when we happened at the beginning. And so they created that. But you don't have to spend loads of money on wood. Because over the years, we've done deals with demolition yards, we've done sponsorship from B&Q. You know, we don't have to spend big checks in order to create edible grass verges everywhere. And then there's private gardens. This is Mary's private garden. Mary is one of the people that started Incredible Edible with me. And I just want to tell you a really short story about Mary. What matters is Mary, yes, but what matters more about Mary is where her house is. Mary's house is at the bottom of a street that goes up to one of our most challenged estates. And every day, past Mary's garden, people was on the main road. Fine. Mary changed the way her garden looked. She took down the front wall to invite people in. She took out the inedibles and she planted food in there. And then a local sign maker put a lovely sign in there that showed people pictures of what it was. Because people have forgotten the basics of food and what it looks like. Here's the story that lets you know that we were onto something. One day, a mum and two kids going to a local school walked past, as they've done every day for God knows how long, but people in this country do not venture into land that they don't own because they think we're going to sue them. But eventually the kids will. And they climbed over the wall and started to pick some herbs and some cabbages and kale and whatever it was, and they went home. And that was the purpose of it. But later in the day, the kids came back with the outside leaves of the cabbages and so on and so forth and put them into that compost bin that was there because the school had taught them the right thing to do with cabbage leaves or whatever. But more significant, the following morning, on the doorstep of Mary's garden was a bowl of soup made from the herbs and the vegetables picked by complete strangers as a gift back to Mary. And when that type of thing starts to happen, you kind of know that's how we are wired. We are wired to help each other if we're given a chance to do it. Here's an example of Dunstable, where they've done exactly the same thing in terms of public realm, but these people had a horrible patch. They are the ones on the top corner with nothing growing on it. And with the thumbs up, we'll get out of your way from the social landlord. They've created a really lovely place that's growing food, that's teaching people, that's a lovely shelter for older people. Didn't cost a bomb, people just got out of the way and let them go, oh, I'm doing that. And then we've got another propaganda garden, I'm back in Chopperton now. Now this is a no-brainer. You've got a health centre. It's a brand new health centre. It's a great big flipping thing. It costs £8 million to build it. And it's surrounded by inedible prickly plants. Because that's what we do with public realm. And then, nationally, we run a multi-£1 million eat 5 a day campaign so that people can connect health with food. Well, let me think. Is that a sensible way of doing it? No. So we went to the doctors, because we do ask for permission on occasions, and said, would you mind if we took up your inedible prickly plants? And could we plant some of our own? And they said, that's fine, as long as it doesn't cost us a penny, and we don't have to do it. So we did a bit of fundraising, and we put apple trees and pear trees and raspberries and strawberries and herbs and all manner of apothecary things at the back. And now we have got patients who walk in and out of that health centre with the kids tasting some of the fruit, smelling some of the lavender or whatever, and reconnecting health and food, rebranding the NHS. And the great thing about this is, you know, it's just a no-brainer. So we do have people from all over the country now coming and having a look at this, because everyone should be doing it. And indeed, we're doing it with Halifax Hospital and with all doctors' surgeries in our part of the world. It should be the norm that health and good food should be seen together through the estate. I've no idea why it didn't happen. And then we've got the job centre. You've got the general idea by now. We were asked by the job centre, could we do something there? Very simple, very small. It's about small actions together. But it was just about imagining you've lost your job. You walk through that top right-hand corner. It's horrible tarmac. It's totally depressing. You're starting to rethink about your life or your money or whatever else it might be. Is it not possible that if we could imagine food growing around that health, around that job centre, you might think, well, I've got spare time now, and you know, maybe I could retrain to do this, or maybe I can get a job in this, or maybe at least it'll at least keep me active till I get a job. Small thoughts, but it's had an impact on a few people's lives. We do it at the railway station, we plant up all along whatever, I'd love to do it, we're all along the main railway line, we've got planters full of herbs, it doesn't cost much money, people get off the train, they snip some sage or some rosemary and take it home with them. It's just being part of that community and saying a little thank you. But we've also taken over bits of a car park, they've allowed us to do it, so that we're growing food, people get off the train, they pick the rocket up, whatever it is they've got. And if they pick it all, we replant it. But people don't. Not only do they not pick it all, but they don't vandalise it. Because our kids in the park are still pulling the edge off daffodils, but they do not decimate food in the middle of town. And we don't come from a well-off bit of the world. So it's interesting that some of those myths about vandalism and dirt and God knows what are exactly that. They are myths. And then we've got the wonderful fire service who have kind of embraced this throughout Greater Manchester. Utterly fantastic. The chief fire officer has said, let community fire stations work with their community to show them how to create raised beds, how to grow local food, because many of the people they're working with are some of the offenders that they're dealing with, and they have found this been really creative, and we're working across Greater Manchester in Earlham and in other parts community food to be shared between themselves and that community. It's not difficult. And then, of course, because we've got a sense of humour, and this is kind of the, I think it's the last one I've got of the slides for the community, we've got a police station on the main road with a great big space in front of it that was crying out to grow something. So we did. We won some wood from B&Q. We knocked on the police door and then we said, could we possibly do that? Because again, you know, we know when to ask. And they said, that's fine, as long as we have to do it, and we don't have to do it. So we built these raised beds and we filled them with food. And no, sweet corn is not indigenous to Tobbadon. It's not native to Tobbadon, but it grows taller than the police and it makes us laugh. And you've got to have a bit of a laugh in life, it's got to be fun. And the police, having started off by believing this was a load of barking mad women with a few men attack, doing this food thing, suddenly started to invite fellow police people from all over the country. Because what was happening is environmental damage in the town was going down and community relations with the police were going up. Not our stats, theirs. And all we've done is plant food. So all the time, what we're trying to do is challenge the use of the public realm, challenge the use of people's relations. We're just trying to have a conversation about how food can change. And sometimes it changes in a way that we'd never imagine. But if we're going to do that, this isn't about 20 people deciding that they're going to be do-gooders in the middle of top of it. This needs to be normal. It needs to be normal for people to know how to grow, normal for people to know how to cook, normal to expect our children to have jobs in the places that they were brought up in, if they wanted. And food could be part of that. So how do we do it? Well, it's, you know, we've no co-funding, we've no bureaucracy, we've not got a right load of money. I mean, everything we do is volunteers. We have one or two members of staff who kind of hold the ring on the website and stuff like that. But other than that, we're just doing it because we believe passionately in building a kind of world. We've got all the fab stuff that's already going on. You're already doing all this stuff. The stuff is original about it all. You may not be growing in a graveyard in that middle one, and neither are we at the moment, but we were growing in a graveyard where the soil was extremely good, not because we're disrespectful, but because it was right next door to a school that didn't have any land, and the people who owned the graveyard said, grow here, go on. And that's exactly what we did. And the really interesting thing about that, because we teach lessons, we've got lessons all the time, is those kids aren't frightened about their graveyard anymore. It's a place of life and death. It's just, we didn't think about that at the time, we weren't clever enough. But this is happening all over the place. Funds from the outside, helping kids on the inside of the fence learn some skills. But it's got, learning's got to be more than that. And it's got to be in our secondary education as well. And my experience of working in secondaries is, it's not easy. I wish that everywhere had a college like you've got doing vertical growth. It's totally fantastic. The aspirational potential behind that is brilliant. It's rare. I love it. But besides that, what could we actually do? Because the, don't want to be negative. Curriculum is very tight. It's tick box. It does what it has to do. All right, that's fine. So what can we do around that? So one thing we did 7 years ago is we started a social enterprise. We started a social enterprise that taught three different types of growing techniques on land that was adjacent to the high school. It teaches soil science, it teaches hydroponics, which is growing without soil, and it teaches aquaponics, which is using fish and fish poo basically as a medium to then grow crops from. And these are three different urban growing techniques, which it is true that by 2050, something like that, we're going to have to fly less and grow a lot more locally. We'd better know for the people in backyards with no soil how they're going to do that. We'd better understand in our city centres how we grow vertically or grow on the roof or whatever else it is. Because what we're trying to do here is to say it's not just about soil on your fingertips, really important that is. We want to bring on the next generation of soil scientists. We want to bring the next generation of architects. We want to bring the next generation of people who won't be, as is the case now, and I've heard them in the school that we are next to, oh, you only do that if you're thick. No. The production of food, the design of the production of food, the science behind the production of food is absolutely fundamental to the way that we're going to move in the future. And we should be a lot more respectful. So that's what we're trying to do. Come and visit us sometime. It's utterly great. We've got tomatoes growing all over the place. We're growing melons in the middle of Tobbadon. And there are all manner of other things. Come and have a look at it. We're not trying to hit the mass market. We're just a learning establishment that's funded predominantly by trying to wheedle bits of money out of mainstream funding and bend it to help kids learn about growing. in so many areas of the world, haven't we got this idea how to do that? So, we wrap up on a street with a tent that goes up fast and down fast, because we don't have permission to do that. We just wrapped on a street, we're going to Saturday morning, why would we have permission? So we just wrap up on a street, and we show people how to cook, what else is season? It may be simple pasta stuff, it might be a soup thing, it may be how to make a simple flatbread, it could be anything that resonates with, probably rhubarb crumble in Tottenham, but anyway. Something that shows people how to live well with very little money. And we started all this way before we were all banking on about austerity, so it's really quite good that we've got a bit of a track record. We call these people our food inspirers, and they go out there and they work in people's homes. I've just got a session every Thursday on our estates, cooking kids lunch, because the kids don't get to eat when it's not school holidays. Plenty of kids have issues around that. So, instead of stigmatising it all, we just do Kids Eat Free, we have a huge amount of fun, it's fantastic, and we do whatever comes into our mind or whatever kids want to eat. Loads of fruit, you know, loads of wraps, whatever. Just really simple. And what's really brilliant is ordinary folks love doing this, and you're doing it all the time in Wigan as well, because it just empowers them to get on and build something better. But there's a whole host of people that don't know how to do that, or don't want to do that. But maybe, like this lady, she can graft a tree. She can show people how to create orchards all over the borough without it costing the right amount of money. She can talk to people about not only grafting a tree, but bringing back some of the old varieties that some of our older citizens can remember, but now you can't get pine, you know, just can't get them anywhere. She can show people how to collect seeds, so you don't have to be going and spending £2 on a pack of seeds all the time. Actually, collectively in the community, you can gather the seeds, and you can share them, and you can grow them. There's all manner of things that single point of focus on food, but maximum elaboration in terms of the gifts that we bring. And then the last bit is the business plan. How do we create local jobs and sticky money when we're a load of volunteers and we've got no cash and whatever it might be? Well, we've got a bit of money and therefore we put our hands in our pockets and we bought a dozen blackboards like that that says Incredible Edible Tottenham. And we took them into our market, which was failing, and we gave them out on our market. And we said, anything that's local, here's a bit of chalk, scribble on, whether it's cheese, or beer, or bread, or meat, or the sandwich, it doesn't make any difference. And the interesting thing about doing that is, and we promoted it. We promoted it, we got it in the paper, we talked about it. We didn't Twitter and tweet, because we didn't do that in those days. But what happened is people started to talk, and more people came to the market and started to ask whether the eggs were local, or the beer was local, or whatever else it might be. And 8 years on, because this isn't a 1 year, 2 year or 3 year plan. 8 years on, we've got more local market traders, we've got people doing street food, we've got people coming from smallholders where they've, you know, been able to legally butcher their animals and sell them on the market. We've got people making pies and pickles and whatever. Not only that, but we've got a guy that's been brave enough, because if you stimulate demand, the rest will follow. We've got a guy brave enough now to go into cheese making, he's won awards from it, we've got loads and loads of breweries and heaven knows what, and every single cafe and restaurants in Todd sells local food now. They know they are giving the confidence to the farmers and local producers that we're interested in this and we can start to support your economy. And now, instead of being the place that everybody went through to get to Hebden Bridge, because that was the trendy place where you ate food, people don't do that anymore. People stop off in Todd and spend their money in Todd and walk around the edible routes in Todd and go into the cafes and taste the local food, because people just want to do that in a at a time when historically nobody ever did. And this was a quick and dirty piece of research that was done on us, because we don't have a lot of statisticians sat in the cupboard somewhere, we're just a load of volunteers. But slowly people are coming, University of Central Lancashire come forward, and then news come forward to say, we want to work with you, we want to evaluate your project, and that's it. But we can see from the looks on people's faces the impact. The biggest thing we've done for tourism, for the economy, is to create a new form of tourism called veg tourism. And when we created all these beds all over the place, people genuinely from all over the world wanted to come and see what we were doing. Because we were just getting on and trying to change our lives. Just like the approach that you adopted in Wigan. And we were blasé about film crews in Russia and America and Australia and heaven knows what. And we're really big in Korea and China, but we can't read what they say about us. But they seem to be smiling, so we think we're on the right track. So we've got people now, thousands of people every year, wandering around Tottenham, having a look at what's going there. Not because we're good at growing, but because we're redefining space. And one of the ways we redefined space, because we could, is we just created a green route, which is nothing other than a stylized map of Tottenham that actually just links up the propaganda gardens, but does a full footfall through the market and the back streets that nobody goes to, so that somebody will spend some money in a local cafe or whatever it is, instead of zapping to the supermarket. Not rocket science. It was done as a volunteer. It was printed for free. That's what people do. It doesn't cost much. And that edible route, bringing people into bits of the place that you want to regenerate without spending any money, it's kind of picked up all over the place. This is the centre of our town. It was a hoarding. We persuaded them to take down the hoarding. We planted up some edibles. We put a sign in there called Pollination Street, which isn't a street, it's not a proper sign, but everybody was fine about it. The council then did their bit, which was to put some flower seeds around the place and put some picnic tables in there. What we've done here is now created in the middle of a very industrial town a green space that people are going to fight for, because it's lovely, because it's right next door to the market. You can go and have your lunch in there. It smells and looks beautiful. It's not full of rubbish, and it's owned by the local community. And the same's happened in Lambeth. We've just launched a map in Clapham. We don't do it for them. We just go and tell them, hey, do you want to have a go at doing this? And then we bring people into conversations and things just happen. It's happening in Eccles. And as a result of all this, it actually has changed the mindset of people engagement with the neighbourhood plan. Because before, nothing to do with me, but now people have got an opinion about how much land they want around their house, whether they want processing in the middle of town, whether they'd like to see the market expanded, if they want Pollination Street. They've got an opinion. And it has stimulated, it's taken 7 or 8 years to do it, people's self-belief that their own opinion is a value. And for me, that kind of highlighted what this is all about. And yeah, we've got groups all over the UK, and we've got folks all over the world, and are they all doing exactly the same thing? No. But they're all trying to use those three plates of community, meets learning, meets business around food, to try and offer something back to their community. And that is why it resonates so well with what we're doing in Wigan. And Wigan is on there. And on the pamphlet you've got there, you've got a great big blog. Because Wigan is the first local authority in the country to say, after the conversation with Donna, we want to see what we can do, already doing so much of this, together, to actually see if we can go to another level. If we can actually stimulate supply chains, if we can actually create more apprenticeships, if we can actually get more people talking to each other and more active, whatever. And it was just so inspirational that we were at the same thing, and it just happened. And then I discovered your deal, which is utterly unbelievable, because the match of getting more people in the community active, stimulating the local economy, thinking about jobs for the futures of young people, all that stuff, married to personal responsibility for doing something ourselves about that instead of just waiting, facilitated through your deal, is unbelievable. And I just, you know, everywhere I go, I tell this story, because the serendipity around us coming together to try and make a difference in the next 3 years is huge. Councillor, you mentioned that last week we kind of kicked off Incredible Edible Wigan. We're not trying to force this on anyone. You've got growing networks, you've got all manner of fantastic things, you've got fir clump, which I adore to bits, it's cutting edge, all that. We're just creating kind of a family that says together we're stronger. Incredible Edible Wigan. We had a room full of really buzzy people. It was fantastic. And out of that came a really interesting conversation with these great young men who are from the Blair Project. And they kind of like, you know, so we're all in there. We're not all of a certain age, but some of us were of a certain age. And yet these divine two young men sat over there who said, well, we do 3D printing. Could we print some plant pots? Utterly fantastic. So we're at the Diggers on Saturday. We've got a stall in the middle of not where we're standing with the library, but actually near the marble, is that right? Yeah. And we've got a stall talking to people about what we're about, but these lot have got a stall and they're going to be bringing their 3D printed plant pots and heaven knows what, because it matters that people see you don't have to just like words to do this. You can bring any gift to the table you want, and we're going to give out these, I've got to say they're bright pink, very fetching, but there'll be a few red ones as well, to give out. And it would be fantastic if we could work with the Blair Project and Lee to actually make sure that everybody could have these plant pots. They could, you know, design a plant pot. How utterly fantastic. All done by these young people. We didn't ask them. They offered. And we went into Wigan Market, and we've given out the black books on Wigan Market. And I've just taken some pictures today, because sometimes people do that and then they're like, chuckers. But they've not. You've got 5 or 6 blackboards up from Bickershaw's nurseries to Redmond's to all over the place. And they're putting up there their local cheese, Lancashire cheese. Of course I know about Lancashire cheese. They've got their Bickershaw's tomatoes, they've got their whatever it is that's local. The lady that does the barn cakes, then the cakes from down the road, whatever. And what was really good when I walked around today was one of them said, can I have another one? Fantastic, you certainly can. So what would be really great is to show examples where it seems ever so small, the things that we're doing. But collectively it's taught us something, which is, if the diggers, if there's ever a place to do it, it's going to be Wigan. If we believe in the power of small actions, as ordinary people in a community, and if we can inspire people to get up and just do it, we can change the future. And that's what we're trying to do. And thank you so much for helping us do that.
Thanks, Pam. I did want to introduce Pam, saying she was...
I was just about to say hello to Nick. Can I just say thanks to Nick and her team for making all this happen?
All right. Karen said that she was passionate and a doer. I think listening to her, you can appreciate where I was coming from when she has an effect on people when she speaks. And I spoke about the attributes that Pam has achieved over the years. They don't matter to you. What matters to you is what happens in the future and what you can do. And I think you spoke about Fertilex and things about community kitchen and rain and different things, what's happening all over, and lots of stuff in Astley and whatever.
Absolutely.
And go for growing, isn't it? What I think we need to do is just put them jigsaws together. I think when you live there, all we need to do is put the box in between, and I think we'll match that. And I know there's passion with members, because lots of us do that anyway. And what Peter and Don's agreed is that we want to put some SIF fund in there, probably small bids, to help people in areas of funding. But what Pam would say is, it's not about funding, it's not about money, it's about desiring people wanting to do it. But with that little help, we can actually do that. So with that, I'll take some questions, if anybody's got any questions for Pam. Jim?
Frank.
Mark.
Frank.
What's going on now? You referred to a grass verge as a dog's toilet.
Yes.
Everybody in this room will have grass verges in their walls, which we call dog's toilets. What was the impact of what you did on that? I mean, I was a bit concerned because about dogs continue to foul the food, but what happened to the dog
foul? It's really interesting. It's really, really, no, not the universal panacea. So there will be displacement around this, I get that. But the dog toilet there, and also, we've made edible canal banks. And you know what canals are like. They're just attract dogs like magnets. Where we have planted food, people keep their dogs on the lead, because quite often it's not just the feral dogs, it's the people who just let them wait on the lead. They don't do that. They don't do that. And it's quite interesting. We know from human nature, don't we, that if a place looks better, it's more respected. And that seems to have been the impact.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'm a councilman in West Lemains in Osterweger, and we just secured £2,000 from the deal for to take out to schools, to get the schools involved in a growing pattern. But we're going to use our local community centre. I would love any information or anything that you could help, to get us going on. It would be fantastic.
Thank you, and I'm not expert on anything, but if you go, because this is Incredible Edible Women, if you go on Incredible Edible Network, you will see how to start a group, resources in there, things for schools, whatever, whatever. And if there's something there that doesn't quite fit, give us a ring. Love to. Thank you.
It's absolutely
set up from Neechwater, the BT team, which is a council team that
members decide which bits of the ward not being properly cleaned up. So if you've got a dirty patch, send the meeting team in first to get rid of anything that you don't want. And don't forget, obviously this would be something for you prior to parliament again. Each ward council has some money to spend on their own issues in the ward to support the community. So they could use that in addition to the SIP fund that Chris mentioned. So we're not talking huge amounts of money, but every little bit will obviously help to get to.
And if we can advertise through our channels, you know, that it's about that helpful framework, isn't it? That's that you've got it with and that not every council has, so thank you.
Jim?
Sorry, Peter, have you heard about it? Hi, everyone.
Hiya.
And all comes for an inlet. We've had problems traditionally getting the central market treat businesses involved in doing anything. But did you manage to do that in John Barnes? And with the produce that you grew or whatever you created, how did they help to maintain it?
Yeah, okay.
I would to have a meeting with all of them and say, look, this is where we are.
Yeah.
This is what we want to do. How you can work.
Yeah, okay. Okay, just briefly, the way it started, I think it got traction because it was just us doing it. Okay, if I'm being truthful, right? Because there's far too much cynicism around the place about people in authority. So I think the fact that it was fronted by ourselves helped. We just wrapped up in a local cafe, we put an ad in the paper, we didn't talk about anything, but would you like a better food for your kids? Do you want local jobs? Are you interested in giving them good food? That was the outlet. And folks came. And it's a result of that over 8 years that we slowly started to shift things. There's always an issue around volunteering and maintenance and good thing, always. Yeah. But what one thing that's really interesting from a business point of view is when people say, if more people are going to grow stuff, that's going to take away from my business. Absolutely not. The amount of stuff that would be grown locally is minuscule compared to what could be done with, say, Vickers Shaw Nurseries or wherever else it might be. And once people start thinking about buying local food, that's what we do. So what you're doing is displacing from a supermarket to a local shop.
Well, a thought went through me when you were talking about it was to get some of this produce to them, to use in the...
Yeah.
Things like that.
Well, the point about incredible effort, whatever works, whatever the community together is doing to help each other, all that happens is good things come from it. You know, and I'm dead happy to, you know, wrap up anywhere that's helpful and have a chat with people. And use any of these pictures that it can like illustrate. We can do it differently, please do.
I'm just conscious I'm not planning to catch a train, we've got a council meeting coming up. If anybody has got any burning questions after that or want more information, you can send emails to Nicola at Nicola Rigdon. She can get in touch with Pam and we can share that information. I think it's small steps at the first, but we're already doing one today.
Absolutely.
So we're piecing that together. So,
am I allowed to say one thing?
Yeah.
Just one thing. I know, it's terrible. There's just two thoughts that occurred to me about the business plate. Because the business plate is the difficult one to get your head around. It struck me that you've got a fantastic reputation around corporate social responsibility. And you do well-being weeks. If you actually stimulated staff to look for local food in the local food week or whatever, the numbers of staff that you've got could have quite a big impact on people's funding, on people's income. So that's what one thought. And the second thought was, I've just walked through that place beginning with them. Okay, can't remember the name. Yes. And I've just taken a picture of the development you're doing with the bus station and everything. And it's just said you're going to recite the market. And what would be really great with all that is if you did incorporate Ed Books and all that, that would be totally mega. So, thought I'd just interfere.
So,
thank you.
I did start off by saying Pam would be doing inspirational talks, and I think you would agree it has been inspirational. How Pam comes across. I actually listen to Pam for another council meeting, but I don't mean anything personal, I think the chief would agree with that. But thanks very much for coming, Pam.